as corny as Kansas in August. I'm as normal as blueberry pie. No more a smart little girl with no heart. I have found me a wonderful guy.
All right, and here we are with Exalted, The Congenials, Season 2. Episode 3. It's January 2017. I'm Devin the GM, and to my internet, going down the list is...
Gary playing Mirage.
Sam playing the Magister.
Max playing Heroism Advancing Algorithm.
Joe playing Laughing White Wind. Mocking White Wind.
Zach playing the Hunter of Shadows.
Well, close enough. Perfect, gang. So, let's do a brief recap from the last session, which had things happening in it.
All right, so... Oh.
Go ahead.
Sorry, push to talk. It's kind of bad when you are focused on some sort of messaging app and then you just start typing 1,000 periods. Anyway, so... we had just finished talking with the Jadeborn, who are these alien monsters underground who are not exactly the same as described in the books, because we wanted to spice things up a bit, I suppose. And then we retreated out and said, hey, look, they're dealing with uncracking the new Jadeborn from the Jade prisons that we made out of the Fey folk. So we went up and we were about to head back when a Hunter of Shadows came looking for us, saying, hey, guys, there's a guildsman who has been tracking you down and has been trying to mess with your shit up in Nexus. Why don't you deal with that? And so we did. We took our 7-meter-tall golden man to Nexus, pretending he was a war strider, and delved deep into the terrifying terribleness that is Nexus, and found this guildswoman who has been, as I said, messing with our shit. So as we were attempting to investigate and interrogate her, she noticed that she recognized the Magister, and before we could get anything off, she freaked out and started to attack us. So we went into a battle mode and subdued her as giant orbital bombardment strikes from our 7-meter-tall golden man struck her in a field 7 miles away. And for the moment, we now have her trapped inside of Algorithm's big giant body.
Perfect. Yes, that happened. You guys went in and picked a fight with Kai Fang, acquirer for the guild, and just annihilated her. That was an easy fight for you guys. No, I don't think anyone took damage.
I took a point of damage. Self-inflicted.
Ah, there we go. There we go. That's it right there. So, you guys have Kai Fang. I presume you're on the outskirts of Nexus, and you're going to start putting the thumbscrews on her, as is your way?
That doesn't sound very congenial.
They're thumbscrews with happy faces painted on them.
These aren't thumb screws.
They're thumb screws.
These are hand enhancers.
And they're hydraulic.
It takes 45 minutes for these thumb screws to come down. But damn, are they gonna hurt.
Anything useful in her bolt hole where we collected her? Or did the blast wipe most of it out?
There's food, maps, letters, parchment, a bathtub? An ice box?
She likes to hide in style.
Well, wouldn't you?
Anything useful in those letters?
Really, no. Just business. Bureaucracy. Handling money.
But potentially something we can use to do that whole, we already know everything, so tell us what you know.
Not her bolt hole, because she doesn't use it, because how often does someone try to murder her in the most violent possible way? But if you search her, like, home or her house, you know, you could find stuff. Do you want to go back to her house?
Do we? We can leave some people behind to, investigate, to, interrogate her while we send either some of the party or some of Algorithm's thugs to do it.
I can do it.
We can from the house.
Or could we just steal the house?
Did she have servants or other staff members? I thought she did.
Yeah,
I thought she killed them all.
No, she didn't kill her fucking servants.
Wasn't there some... Didn't someone throw out some sort of spell? Mortals was the...
I made the lions take a nap, if that's what you mean.
The only thing you heard were giant cats.
Hmm.
They were trying to eat my face.
Uh-huh, and that justifies killing dire kittens?
Yes.
To be fair, I don't think we actually killed them. I think she killed them. We tried to put them to sleep, and I mean that not euphemistically. I mean, as in, they went down for a nap, and then she woke them up and shot them with some sort of blast spell. I forgot what it was.
Oh, no, she used that area smite miracle thing, and then Algorithm dispelled it for us, but it killed all the lions.
Yep.
That was it.
The lions have been relocated to a farm upstate.
That's a euphemism.
Oh, but our resident liminal got a nice pet out of it.
Yeah, I brought one back to life. I'm solving problems, not making them.
So out of character, I have consumed the name, so I could just become one of those servitors, have my run of the place, and gather any relevant information and come back. So in character, I volunteer. I'll go back and take a look around.
All right. So do we want to do investigating the house first?
Yeah, I mean, I could do that. Why not?
Okay. You head to the estate. It is being worked on. There are work crews and people cleaning out and officials around. The staff is just kind of left to their own devices after being interviewed by the local militia and people from the Council of Entities. Like, not the council, but just their people.
Okay, I pick whoever is the highest ranking functionary around, and I consume the name that person.
Sure thing, you're the head servant.
Yay. That gives me all relevant knowledge and so on of that person, so I can basically have the run-of-the-mill knowledge of anything where she would keep her books and use that person to attend things and so on. So I should have, if he has any knowledge of where she'd be hiding relevant information, I would have that knowledge.
Okay, you could go to her study and check into where she keeps her letters.
Cool, I will gather those up.
They are acquired.
Yeah. Besides correspondence, he might not know of, like, particular personal key valuables or things like that. But he might, I don't know.
Not really. He doesn't have a lot to do with her personal nonsense because she's a private person who doesn't let her servant know about her valuables.
Probably not. But okay, I guess the correspondence was the main thing we were after. So, yep, that's done. In that case, I can bring that back and that'll give us plenty to work with.
Okay, I'm assuming you guys are on that same hilltop that you guys were on originally when you came to Nexus, right?
As long as people aren't accosting us.
Well, the one that you described in the last game as the grassy knoll.
Yeah, the grassy knoll.
Anybody making a fuss about the searing beams of golden radiance that pierce the sky and all that crap?
Oh yeah, that's why I was asking where you were, so you can be accosted by people.
Flamethrowers, leprechauns, all the usual stuff.
Alright, so there's some people walking out from Nexus in, like, official-looking robes and stuff, and they have, like, a bucket with them and, like, a little wooden box, and they walk up to Algorithm's leg, where you guys are.
Oh, I thought we were inside.
Okay, everyone's talking at once.
The soldier turrets are tracking them.
Alright, they open up their box, take out a few flyers, put on your leg, and then use paste to paste it on your leg.
They give them a parking ticket.
They then leave some letters like taped to his leg, like they use like sticky bits, and walk off.
And I go down and read them.
the regulators in the heavy coats with the crossbows didn't have anything to say?
I mean, you're right there, so you would let them know if they were supposed to do something.
Still seems like sacrilege. Have etchings made of their faces for when we need to deal with the insult.
Oh my god, are you making lists now?
What are you, Nixon?
I was gonna say, well, I guess that fits in right in with a Soviet commie utopia.
Now all you need is your head priest to drink himself to death. Yeltsin style.
But seriously, what did the flyers say? I'm kind of curious.
The flyer states that there's a lien on your Warstrider from the Council of Entities for the damage you did to public property that they were leasing out to the guild, and the paperwork is your bill.
Out of curiosity, how much is it?
Probably like a month's worth of blacksmith work.
Can it be paid in sundries? Or goods.
At a bad conversion rate, but yes.
Could we just, like, drop up 100 tons of pig iron in the middle of a square somewhere and say, okay, it's paid?
No, drop it on Town Hall. On Town Hall.
We don't really have to pay it. We hate the guild.
No, this is Nexus.
Okay, what is the smallest, most worthless... Koku, we're going to pay them and counterfeit it, What is that? What's the smallest realm coin?
Actually, they use silver, I think. I don't even know if
I know. We're going to pay it in realm money.
Like, script?
Because Koku is valuable. Copper coins.
Yeah, but that's actually valuable. The worst money you could pay in is script.
Okay, we're going to pay it in the smallest denomination of realm script counterfeited.
This doesn't seem like a good idea.
Alright,
so seems fine.
The avatar of a god.
Alright, so scene swipe as Mirage is walking back. There's like five guys with pallets full of bills that are wrapped up, just kind of hauling it off on dollies.
I have nothing to say to this. yeah. That just happened.
This is Nexus. This is normal for them.
They'll take your counterfeit money. That has value.
They're just gonna, pawn it off on someone else who might not recognize it's counterfeit.
At a highly reduced conversion factor, it would have just been easier to drop a bunch of, I don't know, actual gold on them.
Oh no, we're doing this to make it harder for them. It's not they have to store that shit and count it.
That's fine. They're not gonna do it. They're gonna have a servant that they don't pay do it.
A servant they don't pay. That's nice dodge on the terminology there.
Yeah, you just made work for that guy. He's gonna get whipped if he doesn't do it in time. You're literally him.
But that's useful work he isn't doing for them. That's useful work he isn't doing for them.
All right. Well, you kill 0.1 people with this act.
And 10 souls.
Alright, lien paid.
That was surprisingly easy.
I wasn't even gonna bother, but okay.
Wait, could we have paid extra and gotten like a positive balance for fines?
I mean, no, because that's a horrific intent right there.
Actually, they would have had to keep the balance even, because that's sort of their rule, so then they would have had to find our address to reimburse us.
Also, that means that they would have to put a value on the destruction you'll do now, as opposed to being able to identify it later.
So, you're basically talking about insurance.
They're like, what? You're gonna pay us now? No, this sounds like bullshit. This is guild nonsense you're talking about. We're not gonna pay you for theoretical money in the future or stock of food that may or may not appear from harvests. It's like, but
well,
no, you see, if we generate
the fine, it's a license to cause havoc.
Or it's like,
how much
or
is
like,
a license to cause havoc?
It's like, here's a bunch of gold, and I'm going to pay you, instead of in the actual gold, in paperwork that says you own an amount of this gold, and the amount of gold I add to this pile goes up and down from. I'm like, no. No, get the fuck out of here. We deal in money, not economics. See,
yeah, only the realm is big enough to pull that off.
See, if we were smart, what we do is we get Nexus to pass a law that says that the realm will pay for all of our collateral damage. Or anyone else, just not us.
They would never do that.
No, but we could pay them in counterfeit realm securities.
Ooh, I like that. But that's next time we blow up someone's manor. In the meantime, let's focus on the task at hand.
Yeah.
Speaking of which, anything interesting in those letters?
Business stuff, you know, dealings and different enterprises that are being set up, stuff that the guild's looking to pull on in, you know, trade with the south, different routes coming in through Nexus and heading out through Luxshai and the Thousand Kingdoms, you know, the fire dust trade, there's stuff with Gem going on because Gem's starting to really heat up. It's becoming a real boom town, even though it's a million miles away.
Half money will send money and people and things there.
Yeah, so my guess would be that in there we find things that A, both she would be the only one who's likely to know, and or B, would probably be pretty incriminating if other people found out.
Yeah, that's her business dealings and stuff. There's correspondence with some guy called what's his name? I have it written down here. With some Tepet guy from the realm.
Anything egregiously illegal or we could hold over her head?
Not really.
No. The issue isn't illegal. The issue is something that is either incredibly embarrassing or would piss someone off enough to kill her. Because legality is not what she's worried about. She's worried about someone coming after her for revenge.
Kind of the biggest deal she's been keeping on the back burner is that there's an entire stockpile of hardworking, ready-to-go, easy-to-please slaves in Halta that are just waiting to be collected.
And we will dissuade them of this. We will dissuade them of this philosophy explosively.
Well, now that we've taken possession of all her slaves,
that we already had.
No, we're just going to use them as indentured servants at the Enclave.
We did?
No. Okay, so the slaves are your people. That's the entire reason we went to go and attack her.
you're the slaves' algorithm. Your people are hardworking and have low expectations.
Oh, but we're going to have to hurt her for this.
Like I said, explosive dissuasion. Or claws,
okay,
or there's a number
going
of options.
With the, okay, instead of having our liminal do the whole if she's lying thing, we're wiring him up to a sun miracle that shocks her every time she lies.
My God. This is not necessary.
My God.
Aggression against the Otacothonian people and the people of Claslet has to be deterred at any price.
This is conditioning.
Honestly, I just want to ask her why she knows me.
Okay, we can get to that. So,
is there anything in here that indicates double dealing with the guild, something that would incriminate her as in being disloyal to her bosses and so on?
Not really. She's just a person who works in her job.
She's a guild person who's actually loyal? God damn it, we found the only one!
She's an acquirer.
It'll be a thing when we sell her to the fair folk.
She's an acquirer. Her whole job is to find weird and new business opportunities for the guild to streamline and turn to actual process. It's not about being loyal, it's about, hey, have we ever thought of, I don't know, selling fire dust as a condiment? And they're like, oh, yeah, okay, we can sell that to chefs on the Blessed Isle. Good idea. And they're like, okay, well, I know how to acquire it. Perfect. Done.
It'd be a great confection for frosted candies, right?
Or, you know, hey,
I was thinking Baked Alaska.
There's these tiny people called Djalas, and they have little tiny hands. We can use them as masseuses or like grease monkeys. And they're like, huh, where can we get them? Oh, over here. All right, set it up.
Hmm. Okay, so we've established she's reprehensible and we're probably justified in anything we do to her. Let's get to the interrogation.
Alright, so we're inside Algorithm's giant body. And what, is she in a cell, on a table, the Ludovico-style chair?
Okay. What do we want from her?
Well, information about who she's working with and what she knows about the Magister.
Okay. I look straight at her. I'm assuming this shouldn't be a big deal, and I will brain. Hold on. I will turn on the truth that burns. Committed for first scene, visible target, learn the knowledge of them they least want you to know, as judged by the GM. Worthy foes get a spirit saving throw. Is she worthy enough to get a spirit saving throw?
She's a worthy foe.
Okay, she gets spirit saving throw.
She will. Let me. Where are you, dice roller? Here you are. And we're back. So, how is this person imprisoned in their cell? What is their cell? What's going on here, Max?
So the cell is an otherwise is a empty-looking room. There's a chair that she is restrained securely to. And on the walls around her, what she's thinking about is being displayed visually and auditory if we wanted to do that. And, well, in another room, technicians are going over all of it.
Okay. Since the truth that burns failed on her, I'm going to turn on disclose the flaw. Know the current weakness, most vulnerable elements at that time, including any hitting means which they might be killed or destroyed. I'm just going to get the lowdown on her.
And which gives that, one, that again? What was it called? Disclose the flaw?
Yeah, and it doesn't have a save. This one's literally just info dump and how do I destroy and what they are, basically.
You destroy her by murdering her, and she is supernaturally enhanced. Something's been done to her to change what her nature is. She's not mortal anymore.
Mm-hmm. I didn't suspect so.
And I'm just trying to get you the hit die.
Oh, and effort totals.
Oh, 22 hit die, effort 8.
Oof, she's up there with us.
She gained hit dice from last time.
Oh, what did I say last time?
I want to say it was 16 and 5.
Oh, 16 and 6 then, my mistake.
That's quite a difference.
It's not that much of a difference. 16 and 6.
Is she awake?
Yeah, she's there. Fairly pissed off.
What was her name again?
Kai Feng.
Well, she's there, I'll also turn on Subtle Eye of Knowing to see how they altered her.
If
it's low magic or thergy.
Oh god, it's neither of those.
Okay.
This is something that was done by a god.
Okay, so no thergy, no low magic practitioners. Is she a practitioner?
Yeah, she's a sorcerer. She knows, what's it called? Emerald. You know, the first tiers of magic.
The first circle of emerald, or something like that, yeah.
And, okay. The first circle of necromancy.
Whoa.
That's... okay. I look at the others and kind of shrug. I have no idea, but she's definitely not mortal anymore.
Kai Feng, we came here to stop your acquisition of a certain set of people. But I am now curious. How do you know me?
She's what was it again, Max? She's on a table? Max? Push talk, Max.
Chair.
She's in a chair? No, alright. I don't know you. You're an imposter.
What do you mean? There is only one me.
No. You're... shapeshifter. You're probably a... what are they called? The moon anathema. I was told there'd be ones like you walking around.
I am not a lunar.
Well, you're wearing a stolen face, so you can tell, you can say whatever makes you feel better about it.
I have never met you in my life.
That's right, you haven't. Because you're wearing a disguise.
Well, you seem to be at a disadvantaged position, so I would like to know exactly how you know my other me, then.
You want me to talk about my patron?
Yes.
Interesting. Why would you need to talk about my patron if you've stolen his face?
Believe it or not, this is my face. Whoever your patron is stole mine. Or you're gravely mistaken at whose face this is.
A convenient and strange way to go about this interrogation, but all right. What do you know?
About what? About me?
Yeah.
God,
yeah.
Don't get me started.
Life.
Okay, a bunch of people talked at that point.
Mirage just shake his head in the corner of the went, oh no, you got him started on the things he knows.
10 hours later. And that's how I won the war.
And that's why it's called a zoo. Alright, that was fairly elaborate. Just talk about yourself, about your backstory.
Well, I'm debating internally whether how much to tell her because I'm not the one supposed to be being interrogated.
Okay, here's a question. Would an omniscient scholar include biographies and histories?
Only if it's taught in an academic sense.
I'm not a famous person. In fact, I'm pretty...
But you were a teacher.
Oh, yeah, and like some podunk precinct of the Blessed Isle.
Hilariously enough, whatever the magister's real name is does ping your omniscient scholar.
Right.
He writes but textbooks at the Heptagram.
Currently.
Yep.
Wait, what?
Yeah, his syllabus is taught at the Heptagram.
Yeah, see, that's... I'm kind of sitting there, like, I'm just sitting back, running through my head of everything I would know. I was like, and I look at you and I say, this might be tied to what you are and what happened to you.
Oh, you mean... Oh. Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. I look over at her and I say, I'm assuming you're referring to whatever the Magister's original name was. Who teaches at the Heptagram? Yes?
Yes, Magister Inville. He's from the Blessed Isle.
Right.
Magister Eu Talon Inville.
Tepet Eu Talon Inville.
Tepet?
Yes, he just married. You're really bad at this. So Inville married Tepet Alvua after the... that battle in the north with the Tepet legions where they came back crushed and embarrassed. He married one of the survivors and married into House Tepet as an act of getting the two houses a little more lined up.
Good lord, how did he manage that? The Angel family has been...
Well, he teaches at the Heptacram and is married to a terrestrial now. They're expecting their first child.
Lucky them.
Okay. I signal over to Darkfuse character.
Mirage, the one who you've known forever.
I know, I'm terrible with names. Anyway, sorry. I've been away for a month. Give me a bit.
My brain's I know, I'm just messing with you.
I signal over to Mirage. Mirage, knowing what the Magister really is and what may have happened in his exaltation, can you do a reading on his fate before and after? Because we might have a divergence here.
I whisper back and say, well, I think you're presuming a little much in that, but yeah, there's no reason that I couldn't take a look, but
I look at him and say, I'm literally taking a shot in the dark, but it's the best I've got right now.
Near as I can tell from what she said, there's now three of him.
Well, he does have the ability to manipulate time, but I honestly think if it's something to do with fate, he might have had his fate splintered.
I can.
Or we might be dealing with a copy. I don't know, but let's see what shows up in the loom.
I mean, I can take a look, but if I'm going to do a really detailed analysis, I'm going to need to go back to the loom to take a look.
I don't know if this is going to be one of those kind of problems, because I hate to say this, we might have to go to the realm to talk to this guy. Going anywhere near the heptagram is bad news for all of us. So before we do it,
it's not that bad.
Okay. Yeah. All of us can very calmly and smoothly operate around the realm without setting off every major alarm at the place.
Well, other than algorithm, I don't think most of us would have much trouble.
I look at him a little scant to say, you haven't dealt much with the gold faction, or have you? Or sorry, the bronze faction, have you?
That I don't think is the point. Are you saying that you've never had to keep a low profile before?
Oh no, I've had to keep low profiles before. It's just that
when you get around that many other time, then.
Yeah, well, no, it's just like any time you go around that many other exalted, it's really hard to stay low on the radar without using any of our essence or any of our charms, without setting off any sort of passive awareness to our presence.
Oh, come on now. You surely must have more impulse control than the stereotypes would say.
Please, I'm fine. I mean, worst comes worst, I can pass myself off as a mortal sorcerer. That's besides the point.
No, that's exactly the point. Either way, I don't think it'll be too much trouble, but I don't think we've gotten everything we can out of this one here yet, so
let's deal with that. There's more we can ask and more we can learn. It's just that I think we may have inadvertently stumbled across something to do with the Magister's past.
Yes, that is entirely possible, and I do intend to investigate that as best I can, but let's take it one step at a time, shall we?
Right, but this is why I was just curious if you could do a little recon, because I just got a feeling we're going to at least get a lead that we have to look into. That's my only feeling.
I said I would look into it.
Thank you. That's all I wanted to know.
In the meantime, have they gotten any further with their their line of questioning? Because I remember that that the Magister was currently having a conversation with.
The Magister, he probably didn't miss much. He's just trying to figure out exactly when and where he learned sorcery, supposedly, and got accepted into the heptagram, because that was something that he tried to do like 30 years ago and got rebuked, like, and just got shunted off, and his aunt was super happy because it meant her line could be super continuations, and he's just trying to puzzle out where the diversions happened.
Around the time you stopped being remembered as a person, about a month later, if you match the timeline, you were accepted in as a auxiliary, student, and then quickly, within like a season's worth of work, you were brought up as a new professor. You teach the new recruits, like the new young adult and teen dragon-blooded.
This is clearly interfaith. Somebody clearly interfaith with us, because, first of all, I'm a history teacher.
Yeah, you teach history, but now you teach sorcery. And the history of sorcery.
And the sorcery of history?
Well, your syllabuses are being taught in the heptagram now. You did so well for yourself for a patrician.
I need to find who this doppelganger is, and I need to either both congratulate him and punch his face.
After you became a rock star professor like Jeff Goldblum in Jurassic Park, you then married into a war widow from the Tepets Northern Encroachment. She was actually like a veteran survivor who lost her husband in the war, and after an appropriate time of grieving, she actually had you marry into the family.
That is pretty amazing, considering...
When I get my life back, so this is going to be great!
Well, like, the Inville family line
was
kind
of... Wow, this guy sounds way cooler than you.
I know, really? Like, the Inville family line was being kind of pruned off the family tree, and here, Magister Inville is suddenly a rock star. His aunt is probably rolling in her grave if she's dead or not. I don't know. Didn't keep up with her.
Tepet Alvua is, like, third cousin to Tepet Ajava.
Good lord.
Yeah.
I don't think too much of that. They're all cousins there.
Well, that is true. But
still,
I mean, the third cousin?
Officially recognized third cousin, like in the family tree and everything, like on the books.
So he went from a no-name patrician to basically related... Oh, man. All right. I don't even know where to process this.
I'm going to the bar. Shit. Maybe yeah, I'm the coffee.
Well... Yeah, we really don't... Okay, there's a lot we don't understand about how your exaltation works, and there's a distinct possibility someone may have stepped into your role when you stepped out of it and is using it to their benefit. Just, you know.
That seems the most likely.
There is other distinct possibilities, but until we have a better idea how they assumed your identity... we're kind of going to be flying in the wind on this one.
So, there's a month gap.
So, out of character, I have a question, and I just want to make sure I, as a player, understand this before we continue. From what I get, there's Inville, who we know. Then there's Inville, who's now a rock star professor at the Heptagram and a sorcerer and all that awesome stuff. And then, is that the same Inville that... that our prisoner knows about, or is she referring to a different Inville? Because I got the impression there was a third one.
Nope, this is the guy she's talking about. He reached out to her. Okay, someone mute. He reached out to her, like, a couple months ago, and started saying up business deal opportunities between her, the realm, and the South. Or her, the guild, and the South. That, in turn, led to the Infill family having enough for the appropriate amount of dowry and economic kind of strength to overdo their bad breeding, along with his status as a Heptagram teacher, to let him marry into Tepet.
Oh. Okay, carry on.
This guy is like a political savant.
Well, if anything, it would be a perfect cover identity to get you right in the middle of Dragonblooded culture and society, connections to the Heptagram, being able to influence young Dragonbloods as they're training, and it looks like a political uprise in the family. Yes.
Somehow, I don't think we need to get on Shadow Inville's bad side right at this moment.
The other thing that occurs to me,
I'm the shadow, the true self.
The other thing that occurs to me is that it's an awfully large coincidence if the Magister's doppelganger was taking a course of action that inadvertently was attempting to get him killed.
Yeah, that seems really sketchy. Unless it is just a cover story.
I'm surprised he has my face.
That is not too hard. I could have your face just by studying it long enough.
You're a lunar.
Kaifeng yells out, "It's because you're all lunars, face stealers."
We could all be doppelgangers.
Ma'am, there's a fine difference between a lunar and what the rest of this group is. And trust me, they're not lunars.
That guy looks like a guy here. I know.
I'm definitely not a lunar.
There are sorcery spells that could cover this effect. Stealing someone's face, I hate to make it sound bland, is only one of many talents. And that it can be replicated by many others.
technically, and I kind of nod over to Liminal there, he could look like someone else. Unfortunately, it would probably be a rather violent affair.
I guess.
Give me your arm, I'll show you.
I guess, if you want to ignore the text of Psyop. She just pulled a Bible on you.
Out of character. Girl, don't go there.
Theological combat.
Like in Civ 6 where they just pray at each other.
Moral relativity.
Well, you may have gotten it wrong when you were accusing him of being lunar, but you are in the presence of one, and he has a temper, so please don't do that for your sake.
Oh,
not
no,
indicating,
no,
I'm saying that to her, not indicating who the lunar is, but saying there is one here who might rip your face off if you say enough mean things.
Oh, please. There's very little she can say to... Okay, fine. Play
yes,
it your
but
way.
But she doesn't know that.
Play it your way.
The Magister is pretty stunned. You might need to have somebody else try to deal with the other issue, mainly the enslavement of Max's people.
Anyone?
I guess I could pick it up. So, putting aside familiar faces, which I'll convince you were, you're as surprised as we were about that. I'll bet that much. What has got you so involved in matters to the north involving the fair folk?
The north?
Or I'm sorry. When I say to the north, not capital N. I say to the north of here.
I have a lot of fair folk dealings to the north of here, she air quotes with her words.
Within a few hundred miles of Chantha.
Oh, the Halta project. There you go.
That one.
Yeah, I have business in Halta. What of it?
Did you initiate that project, or had someone else tasked you with it?
I got a tip off.
Were you the one who advocated the extreme measures?
Extreme measures? There's a bunch of really hard-working, low-expectation slaves in Chanta that don't know any better. So we're going to go collect them, pick them up, sell them for a premium. It's going to be great.
And what methods had you authorized to go and retain them?
Whatever method I had for my contacts.
Elaborate.
She just kind of shrugs. Well, I know fair folk courts. I had dealings with this god in Yushan that was sending one of his chosen out there to start working his craft, and I kind of pointed him towards the Halta region. Whatever.
Who's the god?
Some man, woman, god with a clamshell that talked about monsters a lot.
Oh, that one. That one.
Sounding familiar.
Out of character, it's Toshiro.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not going to say the name in character. I said, okay, so besides bringing a god into the equation, what other methods did you say you used?
Fair folk.
Right. And did you give them any conditions or rules as to how far they could push matters?
You're asking if I told the fair folk how to do whatever it is they do?
So the methods that they use, so the methods that were being used were entirely up to your contacts. You simply said use whatever methods you wish to.
Hey, 100 or 200 premium slaves. That's all we really needed.
What was the payoff for this?
They're really good slaves.
I meant what were you offering as
money
far
is used
as
to exchange goods and services.
Okay. Were the price, was the price of 100 or 200 premium slaves worth initiating what would amount to a war between Halta and Nexus?
Yes, because Halta is forever away and wouldn't be a war because they'd have to go through the Thousand Kingdoms. So in a way, it would be a net profit for Nexus and the Guild because Halta would be chummed up against the Thousand Kingdoms, and we could swoop in and take anyone who wasn't defending themselves after a war went through. Yes.
Right. And yet here you are sitting inside the belly of a war strider with a bunch of other exalts questioning you. The fact that we were able to move in, find you, incapacitate you, question you with such rapidity, did you actually work through the full logistics of what that kind of war would entail? If we really wanted to, we could simply sidestep the 100 Kingdoms and dump, I don't know, a few thousand converted war chosen on this area. Or even more interesting, bypass the guild altogether, go directly to the Council of let them know that what you were doing, and maybe get your proctor and your associated guild contacts, connections, I don't know, business loss for inappropriate behavior and lack of tact and candor when dealing with the Halton region. You have to understand, there was already an ongoing battle with the hold on, the player, not the character's messing up his brain here. No, the
Bull of the North. Bull of the North. Yes, we counted on it. That would have depleted their resources and made them not have to make an insane strut pull all the way down to Nexus.
Your miscalculation aside, we are here. Your contacts have used certain measures that are grotesquely out of proportion to, well, just about anything. So the question is, what sort of payoff were they expecting to receive from you that would cause them to go such extreme measures?
Their domain is sitting on top of a few old sites they're not aware of that would be quite valuable to them, and I was going to reveal those secrets to them. I've already revealed a bit of it as a down payment, and it was worth them going in for doing the dirty work for us.
Secrets, you say?
Yeah. It's not worth us going in and trying to retrieve it because it's so far deep into the West that it would never be profitable unless we hired up some higher-end exalts to go do the dirty work and not tell them the full scope of things, and that never works out. It usually ends up in the exalt going there, discovering the full scope of things, and coming out equipped with fantastic artifice and tokens of previous ages. It's never worth it to send an exalt into a secret place. Half the time it turns out to be their tomb in a previous life. And Destiny just set it up that way.
Funny that.
I'm smiling. I'm just smiling. Oh.
You're all exalts here, right? Yeah. One of you, raise your hand if you've ever met another exalt who went on a crazy thing and found their old tomb just somehow after or when they exalted. Come on. I've heard at least three stories.
It's not just the tomb.
You know, an old temple or house or building or shrine to them in a previous life. I know at least one of you, sir. That's happened to at least one person you've known, or one of you.
I smile and I say, so she's an actuary, too.
Yeah. It's not profitable, so the guild just stops doing that.
No, that makes perfect sense.
As for you coming here and kidnapping me, that still isn't Halta fighting a war with the guild. And if you were going to go to the council entities and say you're going to start open warfare in Nexus because of something the guild did, the council of entities would point to one of their doctrines, which is war is good for business, and then they would use their resources here in Nexus to scourge you out of Nexus, which means Nexus would be fine, and you would just probably get killed by the emissary.
I'm going to laugh very softly. And then I'm just going to carry on as if I didn't even give a damn what she just said, because I really don't. I'm going to say, but on the other hand, one of the things that I have understood is that the guild handles things in a very, very ad hoc franchise fashion, and thus each individual profits or falters by their own merits to a large extent. And you seem to be in a position of having faltered quite far.
That seems
You very seem very
calculated.
Assured. Sorry.
Well, I haven't tried to break out yet, and you gave me time to rest. And I'm new to this whole breath thing, but I've gained a bunch of it back, so if push came to shove and you tried to torture or kill me, I'm pretty sure I could put up some sort of fight. This is us talking because you came to see me directly. I freaked out and attacked you because you were wearing my patron's face.
Well,
I also didn't know that your Warstrider was a hotel, a chalet, a person? Is it a person?
Also potentially a death trap, so let's stay civil enough.
I think staying civil would be perfect.
So your course of action was dictated to you by your patron.
Gave me the tip, and I do owe him some.
Exactly what is your breath?
I'm not too sure. He came to me in person some time ago, and I don't remember much about it, but I was fairly dismissive of him because he was a old man from the realm and didn't really care. But things happened, and I'm different now, and things are different, and things feel and look new. It's hard to describe, but it's like an itch, and if you scratch that itch, it lets you see things differently.
I hate to tell you, but you're being used.
She kind of shrugs. Eh. I didn't used to know sorcery or necromancy before this. Pretty good end of the deal.
Well, no, I'm not arguing about that. I'm talking about your patron's tip.
It was a good tip. Those slaves are there.
They're not going to be slaves. You taking them will initiate a problem. And it's not necessarily the fact that those slaves are part of an independent group. And that group has far larger resources than you realize. You would have triggered a bad incident for the entirety of the Northeast and probably would have caused Halta, Nexus, and the Hundred Kingdoms to get involved in a war. And you say war is good, but yes, war is profitable, and he kind of eye twitches at that. However, endless, needless war tends to be problematic.
Swords go up and sword sales go up.
I say, well, wars can be profitable to be sure, but they're only profitable until it's your house or store burning down. So this was a largely independent project, albeit motivated by your patron. And you largely undertook it on your own or through your network of contacts.
Yeah, it was a good tip. Plus, we've been hearing things that Halt is not doing too well. No one's heard from Rain Deathflyer in a season.
Let's say we were being charitable instead of decapitating you and tossing your lifeless corpse out in the ground behind us, because that would be coarse. Let's say we wanted to do this politely. What would it take to dissuade you from continuing your course of action there?
She kind of like looks up from her chair. She's kind of thinking. As it happens, those fey folk are valuable on their own merit. It would be nice to have them as a more physical resource than a contact.
I see. In other words, to relocate them.
Relocate them to a camp we have in the west that has cold iron bars and a forge.
Intriguing.
I kind of
wait. Give me a moment to consider.
I'm done. And I walk out. Well, I leave the interrogation room.
I'm out of character. I'm doing this not because I'm seriously entertaining the offer, because I think it's time for us to chat aside again.
Yeah, it's not... It's...
We need to make sure that she doesn't escape while we're discussing amongst ourselves. How can we do that?
Well, Max has it covered, it seems.
I mean, I've also been standing in there the whole time. Because it was my understanding I was supposed to be watching her.
You get to be part of the conversation, too.
I mean, if you have anything you want to say, but having Max at least keep an eye on her is not a bad idea.
Could, like, have a window, like the interrogation windows.
Well, I mean, he said one of the other rooms he had all the details be piped through. It's not like we can't just walk over there and keep an eye on what's going on.
Okay, let's do that.
And that was my point. If I stay in the room and Max is also watching, then you've got two people, one of which is the room, and that might be the most prudent course of action.
I did warn her it could be a death trap if she tried to escape, so...
Yeah, let's make a power play and move everybody out of the room.
Okay. Worst comes to worst, if she tries anything, I do have the ability to knock out lesser spells. You know, she has sorcery, but she's dealing with a celestial tier sorcerer here.
Out of character, she also had gifts based on last encounter, and I would know enough to know that she wasn't just doing sorcery.
Well, no, I agree that she's got enough effort going on a hit dice that she's been severely upgraded, and whoever her patron is, I really don't think he's just some sort of dragon-blooded or mortal sorcerer working for the heptagram. It's got to be something else sitting inside using the identity of the Magister.
Yeah. One thing I can do is I can put a hand on the balance if she tries to escape. It'll let me give off a attack before she can do anything.
Well, I think before we worry about her trying to escape, and I'm sure that out of character, Max would be able to see, and thus Devin would tell us if she was. Before that, we need to figure out what we actually want to do with her, because that if what she's told us is true, and it is mimicked by what's in the letters, she is basically the only person operating in this direction other than her sponsor, i.e., i.e. Inville's doppelganger.
Fake Inville.
Well, right now she has, like, the death penalty and multiple incarnations as far as Autochthonian law is concerned. So, right now she's only alive because she remains useful. So, do we have a continuing use for her?
Yeah, we should probably keep her. She's got some more...
The thing is, you know, if I could dissuade her of... She is like this high level of arrogance. Just, okay, I understand Guild. She's been empowered. The mentality, the way she's operating, but it's like common sense doesn't occur to her.
I was going to say, I agree with that. But here's the problem. She's not the sort of prisoner that we could reliably keep ourselves. So either we're going to be bringing her back to the Class-led Enclave and letting them figure out how to keep her, or bringing her somewhere else that can figure out how to keep her, or we're executing her, or we are going to release her. We need to figure out a plan. We can't keep her behind bars forever. So we personally can't do this.
I can't
have the ability of detaining her forever.
Yes, we do. You forget. I have cryo storage. And I have it prepared just for this. Sorry.
I'm not going to get that planned.
I was going to say, that was a great place for the maniacal laughter. That was...
Whatever happened to her, cut out her... a part of her knowledge, a part of her reasoning.
Well, I mean... Exaltation, if it was recent, tends to make people a bit heady and crazy.
Is she exalted? Not sure.
Doesn't if she's not exalted, no, hey, but it's close
this
enough.
The rest of power would do it. I mean, this is a mortal who can... She this was a former mortal who now has superpowers.
Yeah.
Speaking of cutting out and superpowers, if we are going to kill her, I'd like to recycle the body. Just throwing that out there.
Well, I was going to offer just we've got that old manse where the kaijus are stored, and I rebuilt it as a prison manse.
I'm not going to store her in a cold storage just so she can escape later.
Who says she's going to escape? She's going to be a corpsicle until we're ready to deal with her.
At least give her the dignity of death.
Ugh. Okay.
Dignity of death means can't ask questions later.
We're doing it so we can harvest her organs.
I think we're getting a little ahead of ourselves anyway. What we know is that she is employed by former me, who is probably trying to get rid of me. Or this is a very, very convenient coincidence. She has been exalted or empowered by some sort of powerful thing, which may or may not be Shadow Me. And she seems awfully cavalier about her job and her position.
So?
She doesn't believe we can really hurt her. She thinks either... thinks she can get away, or that her patron is powerful enough to stop us from really doing anything bad to her. We might need to break her of that.
Well, either way, that still leads to the question of why are we going to attempt to violently break her of that notion? Is it because that we think there's some use in keeping her alive? What is the course of action from here? As far as I know, the only reason to be concerned about letting her live is that she might still persist in attempting to do this to make a profit. If we persuade her to stop trying, then she's no danger alive any more than she would be dead.
But could we trust her?
No.
Oh, no. But she'll probably not... want to make, and she'll probably not want to do something to antagonize us after we've let her go, provided we give her a reason to not do it.
I think we need to study what she is and to figure out who is controlling her and what it is that is controlling her or guiding her. Whatever it is, it's gotta be powerful.
And how do you intend to study her? Just keep her locked up for however long?
I have no idea.
If we were to incapacitate her again, might she be less resistant to our attempts to probe her nature? Out of character, we shoot her until she's unconscious and then run her out of effort if she can use it unconscious. Then start hitting her with the sensory gifts.
I mean, we could, but unless we have something specific we're trying to get out of it, what's the point? Again.
We do need to know about her nature.
Do we?
I think we do. I do think we need to know about the...
would provide insight into what her patron is capable of doing, and potentially what we should expect from other agents of it. It seems clear that whoever is motivating her had greater knowledge of the Clathlet Enclave than he passed along, and that this was done either to test or provoke us. I cannot yet discern which.
Simply don't know.
If we were to leave her alive and took some degree of certainty that she should not be immediately killed, what concessions would we attempt to extract from her?
What concessions does she actually have to offer?
This might be an important point for further negotiation. If she is going to bargain for her life, ideally she will offer what is most valuable.
Does not seem to think that her life is in danger. It's a problem, and I don't know even if on the brink of death she would.
If she is anything like the Glock bosses of Clathlet, this is a game to her still. If we appear to play the game, it might be possible to obtain her cooperation Well, still acknowledging that she would betray us, as if the situation would be profitable. That is to say, we might bribe her? Is it correct, pilots?
I'm not sure if we really want to. I mean...
Not necessarily in funds, but it is a tenet of the Maker that all people view the world with theory-laden insight. That is to say, the nature of how you view things determines not only the conclusions you will draw, but the facts you will extract from the information. If she believes she understands our actions, she may be willing to go along with us because she believes she knows what we will do. She will, of course, be wrong, but if she is conduced to believe that we are simply additional players in the game, she may be more cooperative than if we merely display our power.
I see. So, some element of subterfuge here.
It is difficult to vocalize. Classlet does not possess a highly developed vocabulary for this situation. And the Glock bosses are, for the most part, used as deviants.
But no, I'm seeing where you're going with this, and it's not a bad idea. But how do we convince her?
I'm not sure we should. I have no love for this woman, and she...
Neither do I, but I'd rather have her being used against our opponents than simply... Just killing her outright doesn't seem right. It doesn't seem to be beneficial, because she does have influence in the area, and I'd rather disrupt their plans than simply killing her and having them replace them with someone new.
It takes a lot of... She has clearly... There's a lot of resources poured into her. Whoever her patron is.
Whatever we do with her, however, our next move is clear, which is we do need to go after the Magister's doppelganger, because the second he finds out that his primary agent is compromised, he's going to attempt to pursue his goal via some other method.
Yeah, he'd replace her in a heartbeat, or not necessarily a heartbeat, but whatever contingencies he'd have would be triggered, and he'd go through the operation of replacing her. If we can get it back to the sense that she's back in control and we backed off, we might be able to use this to our benefit. Subterfuge might be the better option here. I hate her guts and I'd love to kill her, but that's not the point. We have to actually do what's more beneficial to everyone else. Turning her attention to another target would work better in the long run.
But I don't think that we can successfully subterfuge her. She is... I don't think we have anything to offer her that she would appreciate.
Don't we? She wants 100 or so slaves. We're not going to give her that, but she wants the production of a cloth slot, doesn't she? You don't understand. She's looking at this the wrong way. She could have gotten what she wanted much less violently.
I think you're...
Additionally, she is no doubt of the opinion that we are motivated by profit in some roundabout way. Based on her statement, she believes that the Exalted are generally motivated by their passions rather than the reason. If we are able to convince her that we are approaching the situation as though was motivated by profit, perhaps as a rival financial or productive enterprise, she may believe that she will be able to negotiate with us rather than merely dismissing us as violent and destructive forces that must be dealt with appropriately.
Couldn't it be easier if we got rid of her and then replaced her with a changeling of some sort?
Now there's an idea.
I give him a look and go, so after everything that's happened, your suggestion is to use a doppelganger?
Well, no. But I meant one that puts into her position. If we could get somebody...
That's effectively a doppelganger.
No, but it's not.
I'm just out of character. I'm just loving this irony.
I know. No, I mean, like, we could probably... It would be much easier to get a lower-ranking guild member to fill her place that's loyal to us, rather than to turn her.
So we start playing guild politics instead, and just dump her entirely? Get the region under our
control? That would be
nice. I will point out that I did just attack a guild official helping you guys out, so business is going to be pretty slow in this area unless we do something like that, for me personally.
Well, I mean, how did you attack them? Did you physically harm them?
Well, I killed their lion. Well, I missed a bunch, but yeah, I did swing a sword.
We're talking about her
direction.
We're talking about
her.
No,
she's a guild official. She's a guild official, to my knowledge. And I was involved in an attack on her home. The guild's not going to have anything to do with me in this area.
Oh, you'd be surprised. She's got to have rivals. If we know, if we find the right rival, we can use it against her.
That's my point. If we do that, then I'm much more likely to be able to continue using my contacts in Nexus rather than just letting her go or doing something that involves her still being in charge.
Yeah, I mean, either we subvert her... Well, either way, we subvert her, but we have to figure out how to do it.
What options do we have available for the removal of critical information from her mind without her consent?
Many. Out of character, I have theft of memory, I have excision of knowledge.
Out of character, here we go with the mind ripper probe.
Yeah, algorithm doesn't have that installed.
Irony! The one time you would actually have a good reason to use it.
If we do decide to kill her, I recommend that we first attempt to negotiate to obtain the location of valuables and then perform the action. No sense wasting any potential or means of increasing our available resources.
Perhaps we can attempt to turn her and then use the threat of just discarding her and...
She's gonna pass it off. I'm just saying, she's... Whatever either change to her or mental conditioning or maybe just her own arrogance, using her is going to be problematic because she'll fight us. I like the original idea of subverting her, using her own arrogance and greed against her, but... Doppelganger against a doppelganger is not necessarily anything new to me. Done this before.
I agree. If we keep her around in any faucet where she's in charge of anything or can do anything, she's going to get squirrely on us. And if she gets squirrely on us, we're going to just end up right back here with her strapped to that thing where we figure out what to do. It's best to nip it in the bud and find an alternate solution now.
She seems so confident. What if she's not bluffing?
We get rid of her, it's not a problem either way.
No, what if we can't take care of her? What if her ability to escape is not simply bluster?
Then she would have done it already.
Indeed, it must be pointed out that we recovered her unconscious and at the threshold of termination. If she had a greater ability to avoid us, she would have used it then.
This is true.
However, I must request that the additional data target uplink protocol that was enacted in the previous battle be engaged prior to any actions which may cause her to attempt to flee. It will be more difficult to acquire a targeting lock if she is already gone.
Agreed.
That can be arranged.
One thing I do need to learn from her is the exact time and place that she was changed. If we go there, I will be able to discover who and what did it to her. But we still have not come to a conclusion. What is... We should come to a final...
Solution.
Solution. No, wait,
did
no.
you just do
careful.
That?
Careful. Walking in on that one.
Damn,
this is terrible.
Oh, you're starting to do it now.
No.
My
no.
vote is get what we need from her, kill her, replace her with somebody we can control a little bit easier. We're not going to be able to control her. It's
unless we had,
too problematic.
Unless we had some serious blackmail material on her. Something that would even lock
then,
her up. Yeah.
Even then, I wouldn't risk it.
The plan to...
I mean, I hate the concept of having to do this, but I really don't know how else to handle it.
She is an enemy, and we have defeated her, unfortunately. I never expected to have to do this in my life.
When in such situations, it is best to do it quickly and without thought. It is not necessary to take on damage yourself in order to do a detestable thing. Although in this case, it is not detestable enough.
She was blasé enough to enslave hundreds of peoples. I have never... Slaves are a common thing on the realm. Well, not common, but... It's... Never mind.
From the education I received, the slavery in the realm is not analogous to the worst of guild activities, which this woman was no doubt a participant in. Given that the Fairfolk were known to purchase guild slaves for the purpose of excision, it is no doubt that this is among the most morally reprehensible humans we have ever encountered.
The guild
She does not deserve life. The question now is how her death shall meet her.
I can't do it off the battlefield.
Do you object to any of the rest of us doing it?
No.
So there's a problem. I'm gonna
What's up,
now that you're paying attention.
Yeah.
Here's my nice algorithm. Your charm, the Phantom Zone projectors inside of you are failing.
Oh shit.
The room you guys are in locks down and has a power surge.
What would happen if it entirely failed?
It can't entirely fail due to the nature of how the charm's built. But it looks like for some fucking reason on your schedule, someone accidentally penciled in a maintenance cycle to them, and they overloaded and are ruining your internal space to the point where you're losing control of it. The door to the interrogation room just opened, and the chair unlocked.
Is she trying to escape?
She's walking out.
Do I still have internal weapons?
No. Yes, because you can attack because you're a character. All your emergency exits have opened and people are in orderly fashioning, filing out, but the room the PCs are in has locked down. It's quite improbable.
So, we can't get out, but she's exiting through the other side.
Front door!
Can I dispel this
with
a sun miracle?
Wait.
Sun would not cover the probability shit she just pulled off. This isn't an illusion or a mind control or a spell.
There a window I can see her through?
Yeah, the window you were watching her from. She gets up, takes off the restraints, and is walking out the front door.
So what you're saying is that this thing having to do with the improbable events is outside the realm of fate.
Not out of fate, but outside of sun.
Well, let's start dispelling crap then.
It's already happened.
Devin, question.
I can't be surprised. I mean, what the heck?
She didn't surprise you.
Well, yes, this
she
entire situation is quite surprising.
We're yelling all at once. She surprised Max. But there's a porthole there, and you guys can see what's happening, and she hasn't escaped yet.
I go through
the
portholes.
Darkview, here's the plan. first, ping her with the long-range targeting thing. Then dispel it, then we shoot her until she's unconscious again. This time, we do it right.
Now, someone's talking about flickering advance.
Oh, yeah, I guess I'll just... I'm going to make that target lock, because that way we can be sure the situation will be solved.
Okay. Well, we'll have to... whom was flickering advance into the room with her?
That would be me, and that would be me.
Okay. Whom else?
I can do angular.
Well, I am the room, so.
Well, you're there.
To go through the door.
Okay. So, two of you are going to get into melee combat with her?
Yes.
What does it count as when I turn the room's lighting into lasers? Is that melee combat, or?
It will be ranged.
I mean, it's really close range. So I guess this is a melee fight you're doing. Just with like, it's like with fire wands, how they're melee weapons. They're just short weapons.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, she's right there.
Mm-hmm.
What tricky edge cases we keep running into.
Yeah.
Okay.
Someone be the arranged combatant inside themselves.
Right?
That's kind of
right?
Funny.
So yeah, the Phantom Zone projectors have overloaded your systems and have ruined the power and forced the room you guys are in to go into lockdown. Now, the way out of this room can be myriad, including just punching your way through the wall. Just cut your way through Max's hull to get to her, which would take a round of combat, of attacks probably. Or if you're a Might player, you can do that thing where you juggernaut your way through.
I have a way of getting to her, but I'm not going to hurt Max to do it.
It wouldn't actually hurt him. It would just do damage to his charm, which can be repaired, you know, off camera. You're not going to do hit point damage to Max.
I mean, I've got shapeshifting. Is there absolutely no axe? Like, is it not even like the smallest of holes or anything like that?
Nope. This is a secure room built with future StarCraft tech. It's
okay.
Quite secure, and the emergency baffles went down in the event of like gas leaking in.
Crap. Because it's not a permeable to liquid barrier.
Unfortunately, no. Highly improbable.
I would have to take a round, punch a hole, and then pour through it, get in the other room. So I guess that's what I'm doing.
All right.
Does only one person have to punch a hole, and then everybody else can follow and attack on their turn?
Essentially.
Well, they can't go through the hole I'm going to punch, because I'm, to minimize damage, I'm literally going to go pinhole. I'm doing the Terminator 2 thing where he sticks his finger through something.
Nice.
And using plasmic body, I just pour through the little hole I make. And none of this is taking any effort at all to do.
I think what Max was saying, Angle, I think Max does not care about the amount of damage done at this point, because he wants this person to die.
And I'm probably one of the better dies, except for the limb get in there.
I actually don't mind holes in the hull, because once we go back, A, I have technicians to do it, and B, I can just swap and slot an artifice and fix it myself with magic. So feel free to make holes.
Now, if someone says something
no
to me, I'm
the
no-see ball
sign came off.
Yeah, this is pretty awesome. We might actually need to shift to combat time.
Yes.
Well, yeah, but we all get the first action anyway, right?
Well, her action, because she has multiples, is do that luck thing where she just fucked with the probability and then try to leave as her move. She has a second action she's going to do. We know that the Liminal and the Gatimian have entered the room that she was trying to leave out of. And the Lunar has just punched a hole in the wall and has slipped his way in, which just leaves Max and Gary.
Yeah, I'm pouring myself into the room as we speak.
Max's targeting system is augmented by a loom uplink.
Okay. So that means, Gary, you're mirror clean, which leaves Max with his turn. She got the jump on you, quote unquote. Max. So what would you like to do?
Do I retain enough control that I could, I don't know, make a laser fence or something to stop her from walking out?
If it's an attack action, or if you want to spend your action trying to quote-unquote grapple or detain her, you can give that a try.
I have terrible stats for that. I'll just have to shoot her. So...
Inside yourself.
Well, I'm going to turn the lights up really, really high and focus them into lasers. Well, essence cannon.
Sure. Some of your lights aren't working too well. It looks like the overload took out some of the halogens, but they can be used into laser weapons. Alright, so where we last left off, everyone was prepping their actions. You guys basically spent your turns getting into her, though I can't remember, or getting into the room she's in. Flickering advance is an on-turn action, so the people who flickering advance still have a thing they can do. The people who blipped in, what do you want to do?
Well, mine's going to be a little bit more dramatic, so I think I should do it right now.
Alright.
I am going to break space.
Alright.
A radius of 500 feet around me, which I don't know exactly how it works since there's space inside of space, inside of algorithm, becomes broken, and I yell at Max to tell all his technicians to stay, to sit down and stay.
Oh god, what did you do?
I broke space.
And what have you activated specifically for the listeners?
Hello? I have
Oh, perfect.
Sorry, I pressed the wrong button. I have activated the Lost City Labyrinth stance, where basically a sphere of 500 feet radius has been transformed into an Escher painting, where nothing goes the way they want it to. And if you go left, it goes sideways.
Oh man, that's a real dick move.
And if you go right, it goes purple.
Well, I mean, there's still directions, it's just...
Purple, I say.
It's basically the mirror world from Doctor Strange.
Or the mirror world from the Nicolas Cage movie, The Sorcerer's Apprentice.
The new... Huh?
Who taught you those words?
So, you've set out a reality marble that they have to make a save to move. Oh, shit.
And to exit. They can try to exit.
Alright, this is a problem. Okay. So then, Zach, what are you doing?
Mine's more subtle, I think, but and maybe less dramatic? I'm not clear on the rules. How many gifts can I use in one turn?
So, you can use any gifts that are on turn or, okay, I'm echoing. You can use any gifts that are on turn or just instant or constant. Basically, the ones that say action take up your action.
Okay. Then here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to use my sword ability to go ahead and draw a sword, because great swords are a little big for the smaller area. I'm going to commit effort and to use no release, which allows me to choose a visible target, and they can't die until I claim the effort. I'm going to go ahead and choose Kaifeng. I got that right?
Yep.
Okay. And then I'm going to also commit effort and use Shattering Hand, which is a sword gift. It allows me to make my fray die and damage die always be the maximum damage possible, which in the case of my sword, thanks to Steel Without End, is 1d10 plus 10.
So 11.
And I'm going to end an attack. Yep, and I'm going ahead and attack.
Okay, her AC right now is 3.
Sword.
Okay.
Is that better than last time?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh. Rolling.
She leveled up during interrogation.
No, I just forgot what gift she had last time.
Ah.
And I've corrected it as such.
She's
I rolled winning. I rolled a 5. Oh, I forgot my modifier. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
All right, did you get 20?
I did not get 20. Then I got none.
You have missed then.
Darn.
All right, she sidesteps your sword and tries not to move. move a lot because everything feels really sickly to be inside this broken bit of space. And she will take her... Oh, Max, are you shooting her with the guns?
Already missed. I got a 14 and her AC is 3. So that's why I was asking if I got a 2-hit bonus from Gary's miracle.
No, that miracle allows you to hit her even if you can't see her and even if she's far away. Like, it allows you to target her.
Then I missed too.
All right.
And the laser bounces around dangerously in the warp space.
She will use her gift. She makes a hand gesture that... Or is anyone here like a lore master or like an occultist? She makes a Kimberian sign with her hand and throws down a smite called Tsunami Hand.
I know what that is. Oh, God!
She basically hits her hand on the ground, and there's a rushing sound from the extra-dimensional space as a 200 feet wide, 30 feet in height tidal wave rushes in through the empty space of Max's body.
Good thing I'm still protected by this room that I'm enclosed in.
No, it rips through the room and tears it from its bolts.
Oh. Well, in that case, I won't have to go through the wall next turn.
Hooray!
She can't hurt me with that. I'm still in plasmic body. So basically, I just flow through it.
Hooray for you!
Can I use a sun gift to evaporate all the water really quickly?
You can only use that a sun gift on your turn.
No, a miracle.
Yeah, miracles only happen on your turn.
Unless
you want to defensively dispel against yourself to not take the damage?
Yes.
Okay. Sun to evaporate it really quickly. This is deep, dark, salty water from the acid of Kimberly. What other gifts do you got? Or what other words do you got?
I have sun and bow and Colossus bound.
Colossus isn't a miracle word, so sun and bow, eh? Yeah, I don't think Sun's going to do that. Sun's really good at getting rid of illusions and tricks of the mind and, like, darkness and stuff. This is Sea that crushes flame.
So, how much damage are we looking at here?
You are looking at... Oh, 10.
Oh, I just had a terrible idea.
Ow.
What if I used bow to call in some sort of terrible flamey attack?
What do you mean?
Like, shoot the water. You know that thing where you detonate in the water to make a cushion of bubbles that's softer to land on?
That wouldn't stop this horrible tidal wave from ripping through your inner guts, like some sort of joke about ethnic food against a white guy.
No, but
that's pretty good.
If we set off some sort of explosion in the water, wouldn't that... It dispels some of its ward force, so it just sort of flowed past rather than crashing through.
Yeah, I don't think Bo's going to be able to do that, I'm afraid. Bo is really good for dealing with objects in flight, and I think a bit of melee, too. It really depends, like thrown melee weapons.
Okay.
I think this time it just doesn't apply for you, unfortunately.
That's what I get for not having artifice installed.
Endurance, man. Endurance would have been the one, because I don't even think Artifice might have been able to help you here.
It would have just put something in the way.
That was the exact example Kevin Crawford said would not work for having Omni dispelling against effects. That was the exact example. Like, I use Artifice to make shields all the time, and he's like, no, goddammit.
Okay, moving on. How much damage?
10.
Like 10 before the conversion, or 10 after?
10.
She maxes out the damage number, and it's a straight point value for Tsunami Hand.
I'm glad I bought some extra HP.
That would have been...
I have a Colossus installed.
Yeah, that would have been horrific.
This is why I have the hardiness word, right? This is the reason.
Yes.
Now, I have a question that I'm not sure... So I have to ask it. Does this wave, even though it's a smite, does it count as driven by a purpose?
Yes, it is driven by her purpose because she did the thing.
Why? I gotcha. Okay. I was just unclear on some wording.
Oh, walk between the rain?
Gift. Yep, that's the one.
No, no, this is an attack. She's attacking you guys. This isn't her just being like,
okay.
I create lava with my word of fire, and it just drops around us.
Okay, that's what I was unclear on. I thought she was building an obstacle between us,
no,
and it was causing damage.
She opened up her combat menu in Final Fantasy style. It was all like, beep, 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 smites. Tsunami hand. And clicked it with the little gloved hand.
Yeah. She has many different sorts of smites, we're finding out.
Yeah, she's kind of a badass. All right, so that was 10 damage, right?
Yes. Also, that water doesn't go away. The water's here now. The water lives here now.
Will it rush out through the emergency exits, or does the broken space mean it can't?
Oh, it's going to rush out, but not quick enough to empty this place out in the frame of the combat.
Is everyone drowning now?
So there's a puddle.
Everyone evacuated. As soon as the phantom protectors went offline, they left.
I mean, all of these people who aren't me, since my head is still in the open air.
There's air pockets at the top you guys can swim up to. Yeah. And air pockets under, like, tables and in, like, cupboards.
For those of us who need to breathe.
So, that was her second action. And now we go back to the top of the PCs.
I guess I'll go first. Apparently, one of the technicians had been working overtime and had been installing a backup power system for just such a rare event. I'm going to use a fate miracle to have this unlikely thing be true and allow Max to restore power. Unfortunately, it won't retroactively put her back in her chair, but restore systems.
All right, and is this just a miracle of fate?
That's what I'm doing.
Okay. Yes. Yes. All right, Max, you can open and close doors again and shut things. Unfortunately, that tsunami ripped through a lot of your stuff, so there's a fair bit of damage on the inside here.
Question before we continue. How long is this fight taking after the previous fight?
Scene swipe, but not a day.
Okay.
Remind me, can you miracle greater gifts?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to sunstrike that bitch.
So every miracle costs effort for the day. If you're miracling a gift that already costs effort for the day, you pay 2 effort for the day. So
it's
sunstrike would be for the day.
Okay, so just 1 effort?
Yep. The sun is in the sky. And she is a uncreated / summoned entity or an angel, so she'll take the 1d10 per level, and you get to roll twice and take the harshest result.
I'm going to roll 8 in the die roller, and then just read off the top 4. Oh, okay.
You can just do it twice, it's fine. You can just tell us what the total damage is.
So that's rolling.
You're using the Godbound guy, right?
Yeah.
Pretty nifty little thing Peter threw together.
7, 8, 9, 10 damage.
Jiminy Christmas.
27 works.
Okay.
That seems fair.
She takes 10. That really goddamn hurts her. She doesn't really have a way to stop sun gifts. She doesn't have that word selection. So a bolt of molten light goes from the sky through your chest plate directly into her. And there's like a zigzag all inside your body because it went through different parts of space to get to you in a straight line.
To it was a straight line.
Yeah. Those Phantom Zone projector technicians you have are going to just have the worst day. Who's up next? We have Gary.
This is why everything is shiny.
We got Gary with the miracle. We had Max just attack. Who's up next?
I guess I'm up.
My gunners have evacuated, right?
Right, and they're not pointed at the inside. Those gunners are for outside shooting.
Yeah, I was actually thinking about asking on my next turn, can I get to a gun? And I was like, it probably is not in this this is probably not its rotational arc.
I was imagining a shoulder pauldrons rotating inward, like with malice on them, and they just start shooting into his body. Like, there's like smoke and gears coming out of him. He's like, Worth.
Meanwhile, like some guys inside of Nexus are looking out and going, what the hell is that dumbass Warstrider doing?
They're like, I don't want to know. I want to leave. Anyway, someone was acting. What are you up to?
Okay. Sorry, I'm just looking at my charms here. Or charms.
Charms.
Miracles. Yeah, effectively. Unfortunately, Plasmic Body has to snap off this round because otherwise I can't hurt her. However, claws that catch do pop on, so I'm doing die 10. And she's not a lesser enemy, so I'm not going to worry about lesser foes. However, I am going to burn effort to turn on the Wizard's Wrath, so my Frayed Eye gets to hit her too.
Oh no, bro.
Yeah. So I'm going to double tap for every round. Yep. And I... just looking here real quick. Yeah, I think this will do. I could do one other thing. Oh, yes. Yes. You know what? I'll leave that up as a turn, but I'll burn one more effort. And as an instant cast, put my finger down at the doorway she wants to go through. And put up the barred gates of forbiddance against her, disallowing her for going through the door.
Okay, I should point out that the concept of doors has been replaced with concepts of ripped open holes in the hull from the water damage.
Oh, so there's more than one?
It's more space than doors now. The interrogation room / the inside space has been turned into a gymnasium.
Yeah, okay, that's not going to work then. Never mind, I will maul her like crazy.
Oh, shit.
I'm so sorry, Max.
Alright, let's get my math here.
This water is vaguely acidic and smells and feels strongly of, like, slimy salt water, but it's not actually, like, burning you guys past the massive amounts of damage you already took.
Okay, so I'm at plus 2 to hit her. My claws are at plus 3. Okay. So, let me roll my die 20 plus 3.
Oh, shit.
18 to hit.
Plus 3 from her AC.
Oh.
So, 21.
Yes.
Which means you hit.
Okay. Yep. She's going to feel some pain here. The claws themselves do... Yes. With my bonus to damage and everything, she just took 9 points of damage.
So that's from Wizard's Wrath and the chart?
No. Wizard's Wrath adds an additional 8.
Wait, are you writing them through themselves?
The chart 9 is... Sorry, this guy here. So...
4 times.
4 points of damage. Sorry.
No, that's fine. So 4 points from your one attack, and then you're rolling for the other attack?
No, that was it. That was both of them. Boom, boom.
Oh, almost there. All right, yeah, you claw into her, and that sucks a lot for her.
Yeah, she's getting molten silver tendrils of death just slamming through her.
I hope that water, that acrid, acidic water that she dumped in here doesn't sting her at all in her massive gaping wounds.
Who's up next?
I believe it's my turn.
Go for it.
So I'm just going to have to go ahead and keep chasing her. I've still got the flickering advance going on, so I suppose what I do is I again take a movement to get in front of her, using flickering advance, assuming I can see in front of her. I can, correct?
Yeah, you can see.
Okay, yeah, and then I go ahead and I go, you're not getting away that easy. It's you say underwater. Not that easy. Like I think it. Yeah.
You think it very impressively.
Yeah. And then it goes blah, 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 blah. And I take another swing with my sword.
Okay, so 1d20 plus AC3 plus your base attack bonus plus your strength or dex.
Woof. That's a 14? That's no good.
Plus the other stuff?
No, I rolled a 3.
Oh, no.
Stop doing that!
Oh, no.
It'd be much easier to be cool if I could hit anything.
All right, this leaves Sam.
That's a problem because I'm not sure what to do.
Puncher in the baby maker.
Oh, okay.
Smite.
That.
Miracle smite.
So, I don't have any words that I can smite with. And I don't have any weapons. I actually only have fists.
What? You have time, knowledge, luck, and sword, and time, knowledge, and luck.
You can smite with luck. Yeah. Just random circumstance, beating the ever-loving snot out of her.
Well, that's by chance, I suppose.
Actually, your words are the roughest things to defend against, smite-wise. How do you defend against a knowledge smite?
I don't even know what a knowledge smite would be.
There's actually a list of examples in the book.
Take a look at that.
Is there?
Yeah, and I think the create a foe section, they give a list of what smites might look like.
That'd explain it. I don't really look at the GM section.
Oh, here we are.
If you just want to go with luck, the wall falls on her that she already damaged.
I think any knowledge smites start with you going, let me hit you with some knowledge, first off.
Yeah, page 170 for knowledge. It's like, kill someone with an implausible accident. Oh, sorry, knowledge. Blast a victim's brain with unendurable insight. Overload a group with incapacitating knowledge. Be aware of where to stand to avoid an attack. Know how to block a strike. Impair a victim's understanding of the situation. Luck, kill someone with an implausible attack. Set a group accidentally murdering each other with their blows. Luckily avoid attack. Fumble the assault. Suffer impairments. And time, bring future death here now.
I see.
Wealth is vomiting molten gold on people.
Well, I think I might want to smite her with time then, because I think it is time for her to go.
I was hoping you were going to be like, time's up.
Let's do it.
All right. She actually doesn't really have anything to defend against time smite. So just roll through the chart. I think it's your level in D8s, D10s. What's the smite?
D8s if he's just using a Divine Wrath.
Yeah, Divine Wrath, I think it's just D8s. So, what level are you guys? You're tier 2, which means 4d8. Right?
So, 2d8s, you kind of get out there.
4d8.
4d8s.
Yeah, time doesn't have any other alternate smites.
So, total damage is 6, and straight damage is 20.
Ah, total damage of 6. She goes to negative 4 and doesn't die because of that gift Zach has on. So, time's up, and she just drops. And floats to the top of the fish tank.
Max, the drainage systems are working now.
You guys resolve the combat with violence.
That is how you usually resolve combat.
I thought violence would be the answer.
It turned out it was this time.
So, yeah, a couple hours are going to go by as they drain the swamp and get Max emptied out of all that seawater.
And I do put him back into a correct position.
Yes, you...
Okay, you rearrange your organs back to correct.
You turn off your reality marble and fold it back inside your soul.
I think I put your spleen back where it needed to be.
You guys... Is anyone going to let her die? Is Zach, are you going to let her perish? Or are you going to let her, you know, gain back her health?
No, we've got a very specific plan. We're going to throw her in... Max, where's a good place to throw a undying corpse?
He's muted currently. But in the meantime, I have another question for our GM. This was something we were debating while you were AFK at one point. Can a liminal rip out the place where someone stores their memories and use that to get access to their memories?
I mean, it'd be a great thing for like a gift or something, like if they're taking knowledge gifts. But probably not, because it's a corpse, not a person who has memories anymore. Memories aren't kept in the body, they're kept in the soul.
Oh, I thought they were stored in the pancreas.
Oh. That'd be something a space marine would do, because that's a thing they actually do do.
I do have
theft of memories. They have the gland that allows them to eat someone and take their memories.
Yeah, they do. Yeah, they do.
Now, Devin, I do have a question, because we were talking about a plan based on the fact that memory is stored in the soul, and I wanted to clear it with you.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure memory's stored in the soul, like the knowledge soul, and it also might be stored in the animal soul, if the animal soul's something you can talk to.
So here's my question. If we were to take her back to, say, the Claslet Enclave, fit her with a soul gem, I were to uncommit my effort letting her die, could we use the soul gem viewing technology to see what her memories are?
I mean, yeah, sure. If you want to use your gift to make her undying and then drag her back to the Claslet Enclave and then plug things into her brain skull and then strip her memories out, yeah, sure.
That's exactly our plan.
Yeah, if you want to go full on Phyrexia, do it.
Did you just... Oh, wait, never mind. They brought back Phyrexia.
And normally this technology is used so that you can see all the happy memories and good things someone did in their life to wish them off on their next incarnation.
I mean, I'm sure she's got some happy memories in there somewhere.
So in an hour, she's going to revive.
Yeah, I say we put her in the reclamation things that are used for sucking all the water and nutrients out of corpses. You know, because we recycle.
So you're just going to keep on killing her every hour for the entire trip back to the Claslet Enclave?
It will be gainful.
Did you tell me this?
No.
Please tell me you didn't tell me this.
No, it looks like we just put her in a human-shaped box.
Oh, guys. Okay. There's nothing wrong with this. As long as that cell keeps her secure.
Guys. We don't have to go back there. I have the theft of memory. We can just do it right now if anybody has an emerald on them.
Well, we're right next to Nexus, so we could probably just go get one.
I can literally rip out all of her memories and we can view them.
That's much more convenient.
Is that sorcery?
It is sorcery, which I just was addicted to.
Nice. Alright, that's much less monstrous, so that sounds like a better plan.
Well, it's literally stealing the memories from her mind, and she can't relive them once I take them from her.
Yeah, but it's not torturing her forever, and then ripping her memories out of her brain matter, and then keeping her soul on display to for your own amusement.
I will.
We're congenial!
I know, that slippery fucking slope.
I'm gonna keep coming back to this every time.
I mean, that was pretty Prince's level as plans go.
That was universe level, yeah.
Nicole's gonna just be like, oh, look at how fucking congenial they are.
Hey, we didn't.
She's lit, yeah.
I hear the snarking in the background.
Shit.
I mean, I never made any promises. I came late to that contract signing.
No, you didn't. You were with us at the very beginning when we took the name Congenials.
Anyway, so where's that spell? I'm trying to find it.
Page 65 in the second edition.
It's an actual exalted spell.
Yes.
Okay, yeah, alright, whatever. You do the thing. You take her memories. You got him. Cha-ching! Do you kill her? Do you murder her?
I think we need to figure out which memories we do. And it's a memory per emerald, so...
Like one single memory per emerald?
Yes.
Oh, man.
Oh, I'm starting to think the soul gem thing was a better idea.
This is going to be
and still do it.
So do they have to be quality emeralds?
Just a second.
Yeah, that's relevant. If they're small and insignificant ones, like, you'd need wealth if they were very valuable ones, but we could accidentally come across a small cache of really low-grade emeralds.
And if they need to be good, we could just fly back to Claslet, slot an artifice, and make a ton of them.
That does involve bringing us back to Claslet and keeping her preserved the entire time.
Guys, you keep forgetting, I have a cryo chamber. Kill her, freeze the body in my cryo chamber, then we have our time.
I'm down with that.
But then she's dead.
No, she won't. He doesn't allow her to die. We keep her head separate from her body, and then we...
Okay, guys. The cryo prison is a sure thing.
Yep.
So it says that...
So was the chair.
The emerald.
But we wanted to do this now, though. So, we get everybody back in, fly back to Classlat, and then, and on the way, we decide if we're going to do the soul gem thing, or have Algorithm produce a bunch of emeralds and do it that way. Agreed?
I'm good. So, we're going to do...
But we need to fly back to Classlat anyway, since I have health that can only be regained at a VATS facility.
Right. I mean, okay, I can instantly teleport her to the cryo facility for storage.
You have your ripcord spell?
Yes, they do.
All right.
We should get the... I can get the memories that we want right now, and then we can do with the soul gem later if we need to. But yeah, the it says resources too, so I imagine it's...
All right, what memories... We'll move along here. What memories do you want?
All of them.
I specifically want the moment of her exaltation?
Oh, okay, sure. So to set the scene here, it is the calibration that just passed, and she is hanging out at Lookshy, actually. There's a party going on for the celebration as the sky's being all fucking weird and stuff. The stars, you know, they're gone during calibration. She's drinking with a bunch of guild officials and a few gods and a few Lookshine terrestrials, and there's actually... Realm Terrestrials here as well, because, you know, everyone kind of loosens up a bit around calibration. Why wouldn't you, right? Then you, Magister Infill, show up. The memory is basically you two chatting about, I don't know, stuff. Business, politics, the stars, you know, why are we here? Just stuff people talk about at parties when they get kind of drunk. And then you start laying on thick about promises or ideas about being more or, you know, kind of being successful or notions of coming ahead and being special. Oh, wow. He's trying to seduce her. Oh, and then he does. And they bang. And now she's getting up and she seems a little bit darker. And there's kind of like a black line going from her clavicle down her stomach down to her leg that's almost like a Ebon Dragon-like design to it. And then you guys talk a little bit more about the nature of power and the nature of self-determination and why the gods are uncaring and how man is the only thing in the world that can take back their own destiny. And then, yeah, you guys just kind of hang out for a bit.
Okay, well... See, the reason I took this spell is that I can specifically share it with people, so... I can share it to, perhaps, Mocking White Wind, who has a better occult knowledge than I do, to figure out what just happened. Because I don't think the Magister actually knows that much about, say, the Ebon Dragon.
I mean, it's anathemic, or it's Yosi-based, and the Immaculate Order teaches you a bit about it, or teaches you a fair syllabus on what, you know, demons look like.
Right. So, demonic looking,
yeah,
not good.
Like, you could trace it out, if you don't want to share a memory of everyone seeing you bang some chick, you just kind of trace it out in the sand, or calligrapher it, because you're a calligraphy guy, and they get the picture.
Yeah, I can do that. And I also know exactly where it happened, so...
Yeah, it was a nice little kind of, what do you call it? Basically kind of a bathhouse resort in Lookshy.
Okay.
Away from the realm, so none of them would realize it.
So, I have this information, and now I can share it with you, and... All right. So she has been empowered by perhaps the Ebon Dragon and an agent of the Ebon Dragon.
Well, whatever the case, we have to be careful here. Because if we're dealing with demons, that complicates things. But that answers so many questions.
You want us to kill her now?
No, she could still prove useful.
I think we're cryogenically freezing her right now.
Yep.
Into prison she goes, right next to that giant angry moth.
Mm-hmm. I pull the ripcord, portal opens up, and it's basically a shimmering gateway that's perfectly translucent, and I just walk through carrying her.
You guys should let her heal up a little bit first so I can rescind that effort, because I kind of need it.
Yeah, the facility can take care of that.
Yeah. Once she's in cold storage, then you can pull the effort.
Yep.
Gotcha.
Yeah, I kind of wave you all in. It's like, come on. I tell you that you know where the monster guy was held up before, right?
Right. Yeah, I remember that.
Yep, that's where we're all going.
Max can't join us.
Max can join us shortly.
I suppose Algorithm can.
Or one or two of you can stay with Algorithm and take you back to the Coslot. I'll meet you there once she's in storage.
Before we do this, do we want any sort of more information from her?
That you can pick out of her head at your leisure when she's in cold storage?
Fair enough.
let's not... She apparently has the ability to roll the odds against us in a couple different ways. Let's not leave her aware and capable of doing that. So who's staying with Max and who's not?
I'm going to come with you and make sure she doesn't do something weird.
You guys will be able to put her into cryo-freeze without incident.
Well, I know that, but my character doesn't.
I know. I'm just saying, I'm letting you know for the purpose of transitioning that you'll be able to get her in there without serious incident. After you guys can watch over it and stuff and everything.
Yep. We literally walk out into one of the cryo-freezing chambers when you come out the other side of the portal, because I prepared it for this, and I layer on a planquin in the middle of the room, attach a couple things to her wrists and to her neck, and say, we all want to step out of the room quickly. I close the portal, and boom, insta-freeze. It'll take me a few hours to prep one of the other chambers for future containment. Because I got more than one.
Oh yeah, you got plenty of these areas.
Yep. I've turned this whole place into a giant prison.
Yep.
First prisoner!
You did it.
Yes. Hellish cold of eternal imprisonment. Yes! Put the bad guys away on ice for good.
Ice to meet you. You should get a god to manage this place.
Yeah. Oh no, Owlboy manages it.
Who?
My empowered servant.
Oh yeah, your owl man.
Yeah. My apprentice, basically. He runs the place for me. This is where he is when I'm not, unless I need him for some specific project. I made a minion for a reason. I'm useful.
Owlman goes back to his job of having a quiet, peaceful life in an icebox. It's a pretty nice place. It has like vending machines and stuff.
Yep.
You should teach him sorcery so he can do that trick with the emeralds, and then he can spend all his time cataloging it. Here's her memories of learning how to tie her shoes. It's the first time she had sex. You know, just like watch everything and write this huge, incredibly detailed index of it.
And then you teach him about fiat economics so we can get emeralds here.
Yeah,
or bind a mercury ant to the area and it can go and find that shit for you. Or that one demon that always looks for shiny things.
Yeah, well, whatever we do.
Use transmutation and make 100,000 tons of emerald.
There's a demon that Octavian the Living Tower spawned, an entire race of them that goes and finds precious things.
Mm-hmm.
The harvesters of rarities.
Look at that, with your knowledge.
Ah, well. That's something we can do later. Right now, we have a prisoner on cold storage.
You did it.
Mm-hmm.
Kai Fang, the Guild Acquirer.
I'm not sure I'd have demons do it. I probably would get a Mercury Ant to help.
Not
but right
idea.
Now. Right now, I will bind, and since I have my leisure to recover my effort, I will do the binding on her in that room, sorcery, just to make sure she can't leave it, even if she wakes up.
Yep, the manse basically has an equivalent of that installed into it when you change the nature of the manse.
Yep.
So, presumably you're all going to get back together at the class-led enclave, as Max has to go in for, you know, overhauls.
Mm-hmm.
How long has transpired, so are we assuming that we just got there really quickly through my usual...
Let's say three days of Gombe.
Okay.
Yeah, when I stepped through into the prison, that was instantaneous. I prepped my ripcord for another one of my storage chambers for later.
Perfect.
Mm-hmm. I murders them, and then I freeze them.
How many storage spaces do you have?
Well, seeing as how these were originally built to store kaiju, we've got a bunch of human... I think, at least one other around for kaiju-sized critters. The rest of them are for mostly humanoid, albeit, you know, big humanoid. So, I don't know, 100 or so? As much as I can cram in there. And I have plenty of time to do it.
Eventually, we will need to let her soul go back to the cycle of reincarnation.
Sure. Once we completely obliviate all her memories and store them and whatever we have to do to make her harmless.
Or we could just feed her to Autocathon.
Maybe. You sure you want
to
add
to come from somewhere.
Yeah, but sure you want to mess around with anything that's got that level of demonic taint on it? Wouldn't want to be poisoning.
They forge her into soul steel.
Yeah, my gosh.
That seems excessive.
I'm kind of curious to see
if I could... It's just an artifice miracle.
Oh, I'm not saying you can't.
I'm curious if we can't take out all the memories of the empowerment and stuff like that and rebuild her. Make her better.
God.
Make her a robot king.
Nah. We'll figure it out.
Wouldn't it be a robot queen?
King is genderless.
Yeah, fair enough.
Come on, you guys know you want a robot king.
And yes, we'll get there one out of a Ebon Dragon Akuma, which I'm assuming that's what she is would be so good idea.
An Ebon Dragon Akuma who can draw on Kimberly. Not good. That's like double the spite. That's like spite squared.
Mother knows best.
Just imagine the kind of havoc I could create if I had her arm.
We'll get to that. I mean, one way or another, we're going to have to dispose of her once we've gotten what we want out of her. But that's kind of a...
While we're there, can you take out memories of any valuable things she knows the location of?
Like those things that are... Like all the things that she was trading to the fair folk for their end of the services?
Oh yeah, that's actually something I could do.
And any shards that might be near Nexus where Algorithm is before we leave?
Probably, yeah, that makes... But each individual
Someone
memory...
Someone isn't up to just stealing the entire house.
We'll get to that. Actually, we're probably going to have to call it now.
Yes, we should be wrapping as it's getting pretty late for folk. So,
alrighty then.
So yeah, you guys dealt with your prisoner in the most violent way possible because she decided not to go quietly.
Well, I mean, I wouldn't either, but...
You've learned shocking new things about the nature of what's going on with Halta, and we have a nice lead-in now that you guys are back in the class-led enclave area to interact with Halta and Rain Deathflyer and things that are happening now that Joe's back.
Mm. and also from here to pursue the various doors that have been opened relating to the Magister, because that issue is not going to rest idle.
No. But admittedly, the fact that there is Arad the Hunter and the Fae folk still threatening us should probably be dealt with first. If you could send Arad after Shadow Me, that could be interesting.
He might get confused. You want to risk that?
Well, listen, don't fight me. Fight Evil Me. Evil Me lives on the Blessed Isle. Evil Me's, you know, he has like a wife and no sorcery. He's totally more worthy prey than I am.
Probably is.
And a bunch of his relatives are exalted.
There, it's at like some... all five of you are exalted, and you're right here.
But we can fly away really fast.
You should run.
At some point, we're going to have to figure out which one of the is the evil Magister and shoot him.
Oh man! I forgot to mention. I'm sorry, but the Magister in the flashback you saw had a goatee.
Yep, knew that was coming.
There we go.
I forgot to fucking mention it, and I intentionally, like, made note of it.
We need some sort of doppelganger password.
It would be funnier if it was reversed. Like, our Magister had the goatee, but the other one was the one without the goatee.
Well, I did have a goatee for about 3 years ago.
So... signing off then before we get into discussion.
Yeah, all right. So this was what was it? I'm Devin the GM.
This is Gary.
This is Sam.
This is Jones.
This is Zach.
And this was sponsored by Nobody, signing off.
I don't want to set the world on fire. I just want to start a flame in your heart.